Okay, so asking about stuttering therapy techniques, it's a very big question because the answer can prolong right from the first session to the maintenance and the sustenance and transfer and everything. But lots to say for this one question. Let us talk about the basics of the stuttering therapy and activities that we can use. So the question actually requires more information because before I suggest, I should know that are you talking about a child versus an adult? Are you talking about someone who is aware about the problem versus someone who is unaware about the problem versus someone who, if you are dealing with a child, so if should I use an indirect approach or a direct approach? But let's just consider an ideal case where we are talking about an adult who is aware about the problem and he or she has referred himself to you with a complaint that I am unable to produce a clear, fluent speech. So this person is the one who knows that he has a problem. Good prognosis because he himself wants to do something about it, and we can use direct therapy technique because he is aware about his problem. So when you are dealing with stuttering, you need to understand that there are two big approaches. You can use fluency shaping therapy techniques or you can use stuttering modification approach. Before I begin with any of this, let me just make it clear that there are multiple therapy techniques included under each of them. And you can use any of them depending on what you are comfortable with, what you feel your patient will be benefiting with. And let's just consider a couple of them and fit in right there in fluency and stuttering modification. So my first session will be totally about counseling the patient. Of course, a detailed case history followed by which I'll be counseling the patient. When I counsel the patient, my main important point here would be to emphasize and make it clear in his head that, you know what, your mouth is the same device that produces a stutter-free speech and a stuttered speech. How do I do that? One, if he is not aware, I will make sure that I make him experience a stutter-free speech. So we all know fluency-inducing situations are there where the person, if he is talking to a pet, he is singing, if he is talking to someone who is younger to him, that's the time when he produces a non-stutter speech. If the person already knows about it, you pinpoint them and you make it to, you know, get it under their notice and just tell them that, you know what, the same mechanism produces a stuttered speech and a non-stuttered speech, which clearly tells you that you are in control for your speech. Once you put this seed in their mind, they at least have this understanding that, you know what, this is a problem that has a solution in my hand. And it's not something because the theories in their mind are somewhere, you know, I just can't do anything about it and something like that, which we need to just stop at that moment, right at our first session. Then we move on to our actual therapy session, where if I'm using a fluency shaping approach, I first start building my session by building an ideal mode of pattern of breathing. What's an ideal pattern of breathing? We say it's abdominal breathing because it's the deep breathing approach wherein I get enough of air supply for my speech to continue.